Good evening. I'm Jim Lehrer of the NewsHour on PBS, and I welcome you to the first of three 90-minute debates between the Democratic candidate for president, Vice President Al Gore, and the Republican candidate, Governor George W. Bush of Texas. How would you go about, as president, deciding when it was in the national interest to use U.S. force, generally?
Well, if it's in our vital national interests, and that means whether or not the mission was clear, whether or not it was a clear understanding as to what the mission would be. Thirdly, whether or not we were prepared and trained to win. And finally, whether or not there was an exit strategy. I would take the use of force very seriously. I would be guarded in my approach. I don't think we can be all things to all people in the world. I think we got to be very careful when we commit our troops. The Vice President and I have a disagreement about the use of troops. He believes in nation building. I would be very careful about using our troops as nation builders. I think that people need to be held responsible for the actions they take in life. I think that's part of the need for a cultural change. We need to say that each of us need to be responsible for what we do, and people in the highest office of the land must be responsible for decisions they make in life.
It's Britney, bitch.
And Iraq, everywhere like such a.
I'm supposed to be the franchise player, and we're in here talking about practice.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Out, Charlie!
Our next-door neighbors are foreign countries.
I call upon all nations to do everything they can to stop these terrorist killers.
Thank you.
Now watch this drive.
Hey, everybody. So this is a bonus episode. It's more of an interview than our usual episode format. And I sometimes feel like podcast interviews can be like lazier than a regular episode. And I feel bad. So we will be coming back in 1 week from today with a regular episode rather than our usual bi-weekly schedule. So look for an episode on February 10th, 1 week from today.
Hey, everybody. It's your Remember Shuffle. My name is Ben. With me, as always, is my co-host, Giordano.
Hello. How are you doing?
And today we are joined by filmmaker Chris Bell. Say hi, Chris.
Hi, Chris.
Fuck. Oh,
had to do it. Yeah. Had to get him.
And today we are going to be discussing two things. We will be doing a broad strokes impressionistic painting of the Bush administration from 2000 to its end in 2008. And then we will be discussing a documentary made by Chris called Miss Me Yet that is about capturing the feeling of the Bush administration through archival footage. And it rocks. It's excellent. Remember Shuffle recommendation, the Means TV documentary, Miss Me Yet.
Yeah, so much of this podcast is about trying to put you in the milieu of the 2000s to get a sense for what the cultural feeling was like. And watching this series will put you in it so much better than like any episode of our show would. Seeing the press conferences, each episode is 1 year of the Bush presidency, and you've put together 25 to 30 minutes per year of the best footage from Bush press conferences, from interviews in Iraq, from TV ads, and it's really, really spectacular. I couldn't get enough of it. It was really excellent.
No, thank you. That's a good endorsement, people. Hit pause, watch it, come back.
Well, I don't know about that.
Don't listen to the whole thing. There's no spoilers. Like, you lived through it, right? So,
well, yeah, I mean, one thing I find so discouraging about the reception of the Bush presidency, and I think you and I are on the same wavelength here when I see how you end the doc with that Ellen interview of George W. Bush, is that he has been normalized post-Trump derangement syndrome, even by the polite libs. And I have had this conversation or some variation on this conversation with left of center people saying something along the lines of, yeah, Bush was bad, but he's no Trump, right? Or as someone said to me, there is no punishment bad enough for Trump, but Bush was just a useful idiot for some evil people, right? This has become this narrative that Bush was this misguided dupe, and maybe Cheney was the real brains of the evil, maybe Rumsfeld, maybe any of the other ghouls, but he's just a guy, he's just a dude. But Trump is this existential threat. And I think it comes down to the difference between being an effectual monster or an ineffectual monster. So Donald Trump wanted to do all these monstrous things, but he was too stupid and lazy to accomplish most of it. Bush actually did do the monstrous things. He actually successfully stole an election to start his presidency. The Global War on Terror, the Patriot Act. Effectual monster, in my mind, is way worse than an ineffectual one because they get results. I don't care so much about the intention. And it's something that if you lived through the Bush presidency, and if you were a little bit politically keyed in at the time, this is just enraging. Both of it. Both the normalization of Bush in polite society and people making this hack comparison between him and Trump.
The only time you really remember it, unless you were very, very, very personally affected by it, is through the kind of media telling you what's going on. So like when they're telling you that he paints pictures now because he feels bad and there's no other context given, you know, it's very contextless. It's just he was the president and now he does this. And it's like he had no other option. And we're not going to explain any of that. There's so much that the media gives you that's without explanation, without any useful background. So then you get this weird thing of like, okay, I knew it was bad, but maybe it wasn't so bad. And this guy, Trump, is still with us. And he's so brazen that it must be worse, right? Because you took everything else for granted. It's like the surveillance stage, like that sucks, but now I'm still living. It's the classic, so many contradiction, piling on of contradiction you just have to live through. And personally speaking, I am left. I think for a lot of people who probably consider themselves center or whatever, they just kind of live through the contradictions and somehow they like smash everything together to make it make sense, even though it doesn't. So in that sense, someone who's like super in your face, like Trump, who's disrespectful to this system that we accept is really great and perfect and there's no better thing in the world, even though we don't really look into that, it seems worse. You know, there's respect for the system, and which is drilled into us from day one, over and over and over and over. Everything has that acceptance. Everything you experience and watch, everything has that.
That's the sense I got from the doc, definitely. Because half of the doc was the press conferences that I did see in the 2000s on our side, on the American side. And then all of this great footage from around the world that I had never seen before. And it added the other half of the context that you need to see if you're going to see George Bush deliver a line like, you know, the difference between us and our enemies are that we respect human life, especially the innocent ones. And it's like, if you're, you know, in living in America and you only see that, you're like, damn, that really does sum it up. And then in your doc, you do a great job of cutting from that to what's actually happening on the ground in Iraq and interviewing Iraqi people, speaking about how their lives have been affected and how they see the conflict.
Yeah.
What's interesting to me is that even existed, because I didn't know. Like, it's all like pulled from the same news sources. I didn't shoot these interviews. They were taken at the time. I assume they were aired in some capacity or at least made available, and it just didn't really take. And it kind of reminds me of the whole Metal Gear Solid 2 idea of media, of just like, which is very American, is just like flooding. You have the freedom. We're not going to censor anything, you know, overtly. We're not going to do that. But what they do is they flood you with so much information, and it's not necessarily curated, or it's curated in a certain way, but it's mostly just so much information that nothing's censored, because you would never be able to find it and pick part. It's just like too much. You're like awash in all of it. So that really shocked me that these things exist and they are telling another side of the story or an important aspect of the story that you're not seeing. And I felt that was really important to include, because it's obviously something I wanted to recontextualize all of this and recontextualize the Bush and the regime and the war on terror. But yeah, that really reminded me. I think that's perfectly summed up in a little game called Metal Gear Solid 2.
And I think you hit the nail on the head when you talk about what's easier than resolving all these contradictions. I think it comes down to, at a certain point, if you can't resolve the contradictions of empire and the contradictions of this thing that looks like a democracy, but maybe has all these built-in undemocratic elements, you can always look at the discourse, right? And if you are like a nice newshead lib, the difference is like Trump's out there calling the developing world shithole countries, and we can clutch our pearls and weep for the public discourse. But Bush can graciously destroy the developing world, right? Bring apocalyptic violence upon them, but do it in a way that doesn't offend people's nice sensibilities. And, you know, rather than resolving the contradictions, we can look at that surface level discourse and tone.
Yeah, people really ran with that. that. But it, again, is like the system kind of reproducing itself of just being, well, we try our best and we are the best. So when stuff happens, it's for a good reason. But for Trump to be like, oh, this country is shitty, you can't even have the discussion of, okay, like, let's say maybe it is shitty in some ways. Why is it shitty? Is it our fault? Is it the underdevelopment?
Is it the fact that Haiti paid reparations to France into the 1950s for their rebellion in the early 19th century?
Right. There's all these things that you can then point to and then start to maybe have the conversation and repair relations and repair countries and allow them to, let's say, do a little land reform, which is never allowed to develop. And you can't have those conversations. And we focus on the language presented instead when we could have the actual conversation of what happened, how are we culpable in it, and how can we actually be part of the solution?
So there's our hook for the episode. It's our first of what I'm sure is going to be many episodes on Bush era content. I've been pitching Giordano on a Hurricane Katrina episode for years. And now that we've had our first very special episode with Pat Tillman, we might be able to do this. But consider this your first episode, your Amuse Bush, where we will be going broad strokes to try and capture the vibe of those 8 years, because I think that they are incredibly consequential for the world that we live in now. That's part of the why. Then the other part of the why is that we both love Chris's doc and we have this subject matter expert on the pod. So yes, consider this your first little taste. We're not going to cover everything in nearly the depth that we normally do.
But yeah, we will talk broadly about the 2000 election, the war on terror, his education reform program, anthrax, Trina, and we'll finish up with some questions specifically about the documentary series. So we'll start with the 2000 election, which I think makes sense given that it's how Bush comes into our lives for the most part. And there were some really great, everybody knows that it starts off with this controversy with the hanging chads and the Supreme Court case. But, you know, Ben and I were only like 9 or 10 when this was happening. So not as much of this we had seen as it was happening. And it really took me back to realize Al Gore always gets this reputation for being boring, but this guy has the election taken from him at one point, and he's giving it with like a Hank Hill level of like intensity where he's just like, the election was stolen from me. And I don't even think he uses the word stolen.
He's like the most
impassionate.
We are just demanding a hand recount or whatever.
Ignoring votes means ignoring democracy itself. And if we ignore the votes of thousands in Florida in this election, how can you, or any American, have confidence that your vote will not be ignored in a future election? That is all we have asked since Election Day, a complete count of all the votes cast in Florida. Not recount after recount, as some have charged, but a single full and accurate count. We haven't had that yet. Great efforts have been made to prevent the counting of these votes. Lawsuit after lawsuit has been filed to delay the count and to stop the counting for many precious days between Election Day and the deadline for having the count finished. And this would be over long since, except for those efforts to block the process at every turn.
Chris, if you had to summarize what went down, I've tried to look into this judicial coup, because on paper, it should be interesting. They did steal an election from in front of us. Then you get into the nitty gritty and it's like, okay, we're going to recount certain counties, but not others, but we want the state, but there's also a deadline. When you get into the nitty gritty, it's much more boring, but you included footage of what looked like a Jan 6 style stop the steal riot of some kind in your first episode of the doc.
Stop the count, stop the fraud, stop the
What went down in 2000?
There were what you see in that footage you mentioned about seeming like January 6th is called the Brooks Brothers Riot, which is called that, referred to that because they're like nicely dressed guys.
A lot of polo shirts, yeah.
Yeah. All going to a place, crowding a place and making their presence known and shouting. They didn't go as far as the January 6th people, but it's something very similar. It's like a pretty apt parallel. A lot of it has to do with Florida. I don't know if you guys remember Elian Gonzalez, Miami Cubans. Cuba always comes up, but part of it too is Florida and shenanigans with Jeb Bush messing with vote count and that kind of thing. So all these crazy things happen and it causes media frenzy. And I believe it's one of the first times that it had gotten this crazy, at least in the presence of the media apparatus. I know there is debates what happened during Carter's reelection and Reagan with Iran hostage, but nothing such as this had happened. So that's basically it. It became like a thing where like they were counting and recounting, like votes were disappearing, and there was such like a frenzy. And because there was so much faith in the system as it was, you have someone like Al Gore conceding defeat, because if he had challenged, it would be bad for the system and it would cause loss of faith in the system, is what he said. So he just kind of backed off, which is at this point very silly, you know, a very silly thing to have thought and said.
Yeah, yeah, like, thanks, dude. Thanks for what you did for the integrity of the system, Al Gore.
Yeah, not even in hindsight. I feel like even at the time, you're like, what are you doing? And that's kind of, it feels very on brand for, I would say, Democrats to just be like, well, we don't want to push it. I mean, what if we push it and then the right sees what we're doing and then they do it, even though it's like a power struggle and they're going to do it anyway? Like, are you kidding?
Again, I'm not up on all the nitty gritty, but I do know this. The Supreme Court stopped people from counting votes in a decision where some of the justices were appointed by one of the plaintiff's fathers. And in that decision, they said that this decision cannot act for precedent in future decisions. It doesn't look great. But I remember in the 2000s hearing people say the fact that there wasn't a coup or a civil war, that proves the resilience of the system. Because when you have disputed elections in other places, sometimes that spirals out of control and it's bad. But not here in America, baby. We got Bush. What a grim, macabre victory for the system.
Yeah, I have one fun fact is future Supreme Court Justice Amy Coney Barrett was part of that recount halt. I believe there's a picture of her there. And also, to get into more of the shenanigans in Florida, there's actually a documentary called Bush Family Fortunes that really focuses on that. But yeah, it's crazy. And I do wonder, the biggest thing is, because this is such an obvious election fraud thing that we just kind of accept and move on, like it's in the lexicon, what would an Al Gore presidency have been like? And I honestly, I don't have like high hopes for what that would have been like in terms of, you know, might get a much earlier green energy plan, which is honestly better than nothing. But does 9/11 happen? What happens if it does, if something similar like that does happen? And how does that end up? So I'm not really super optimistic that things would be wildly different, because again, we still have the system still has its same objectives and directives and that kind of thing.
I mean, I don't want to say something that gets us kicked off the internet. Like, I guess that depends on if you think Bush did 9/11 or not. But no, I kid. And it's actually a great segue to our next topic, which is the most consequential thing of the Bush administration is the global war on terror. I don't want to get into the macabre and grotesque business of counting bodies, but according to the Watson Institute for International and Public Affairs, which is some think tank at Brown University, I don't know, take it with a grain of salt, it's coming from an Ivy, but or don't, I don't know. I don't like to put these schools up on a pedestal, but according to this institute, forgive my Sorkin-esque rapid fire of numbers, in the post 9/11 war zones, the direct and indirect death toll is somewhere between 4.5 and 4.7 million people. And only compared to that, 7,000 U.S. soldiers have died. That's the kind of asymmetry that we're dealing with here. 38 million people were displaced in the wars in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Syria, Libya, Yemen, Somalia, and the Philippines. The cost of all these wars to the U.S. taxpayer is $8 trillion. And all of this starts in the Bush era, and it's not over, because apparently America is still doing counterterrorism operations using the same kind of legal jurisdictional apparatus in over 70 countries. There's only 190 countries on Earth. That means we're doing counterterrorism in almost a third of all of the countries. And I think one thing that you really got across in your doc really well is just how fucking keyed up America was after 9/11 for war. We don't get to these numbers of apocalyptic violence without the populace having some say in it. And that public opinion didn't manifest organically. It didn't happen on accident, right? In your 2003 episode, we have a newscaster say, oh, the protesters are out from London to San Francisco, even though 70% of Americans support the war, right? And those are the numbers. That was the feeling. But that doesn't exist in a vacuum. The consent manufacturing, the Bush administration, blah, 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 blah. Maybe, just maybe, a guy as boring as Al Gore could have brought the temperature down, you know?
Yeah, maybe. It's funny, that clip you reference, that's with the Dixie Chicks, who are, they changed their name, right?
They're the Chicks now, yeah.
The Chicks. I was going to say the Dixies. No, the Dixie part was bad. Yeah, and that's the reinforcing thing, because she's like, why did you say this? And then in my voiceover, I'm going to be like, even though Americans support the war, and that's the context you get. You're not going to say who did 9/11 versus Saddam Hussein and Iraq being totally a separate thing. You know, we're not going to do that. It's just kind of dropped in to the voiceover, not even in the, it's like precedes the interview. So there's like all these little things that are giving you the context for the situation. Like these things are just accepted. And the media just goes on and on and on and on and on to do that.
Demonstrators were in the streets from London to San Francisco. Even though 70% of Americans were clear that the protesters were wrong and it was time to go to war.
Just 15 words, but they were 15 words. Just so you know we're ashamed, the President of the United States is from Texas. Why did you say it?
Out of frustration. At that moment on the eve of war, I had a lot of questions that I felt were unanswered.
And what I'll say about Al Gore is, yeah, maybe. I think the fact that there was an attack here and it was a huge spectacle and there hasn't been something like that since Pearl Harbor, that had a lot to do with things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, could Al Gore reframe such a spectacle? I don't know. But there's also things that could happen without, doesn't matter who the president is. If you think about Jimmy Carter, you kind of have the same little memory of him, or his personality is like kind of like a nice guy, like maybe someone say boring. Like Al Gore.
Southern Democrat, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But through him, you have stuff going on such as...
I mean, that's when the CIA in Afghanistan starts, right? That's when the bear trap gets laid.
Yeah, yeah. So the Mujahideen were funding and training the Mujahideen and future Al-Qaeda leader Osama bin Laden. And then you're not even getting stuff straight from the CIA because there's so much oversight over the CIA at that time that they kind of make an offshoot called the Safari Club, which involves George H.W. Bush and other people where they're just doing CIA shit anyway with no oversight. So to that degree, does it matter if the president is a nice guy or not? And I do think that the person in that chamber, a huge amount of power, can do things. I'm just saying there are other ways to go around and do what you want to do anyway. So yeah, I guess it's hard when you make a series about a president, but you're like, but you know, they could still kind of do shit. But that is also part of the reason why in this series that you're getting a lot of pop culture references and stuff like that to kind of broaden the scope and at least acknowledge the system that is playing out.
This is the new millennium, and now there's the Skeeter. It's more fun than anything you've ever ridden.
This is the sleek, modern scooter that's taking the country by storm.
Now that's what I call fun.
I love that stuff. All of the pop culture references, I think, were like some of my favorites, just because it did reinforce how much the war was at arm's length for most of the country. I thought it was a very interesting contrast to something like World War II, where it's like, oh, we're going to raise the income tax rate to pay for the war. We're going to have rationing, going to have a draft. And how the war was sold to most Americans is you don't have to do anything. We're actually going to lower tax rates. You can still enjoy the facials and get a loan.
Watch Tarzan on the WB network.
Yeah. And if you want, you can get a nice Hummer just like the troops and drive that around. And the ads that you show in the doc, especially going from the war zone back to the ad, was just like this great sense of how little the war affected us and how much it affected the people we were attacking. That is how the government seems to have sold the war, is like, don't worry, your life won't be affected at all. You won't have to give up anything. We're just going to do violence on your behalf, and you can still enjoy the Tarzan series. And the foot massager.
Yeah, I think it was the this present time where they were just, we knew that the people being able to see what was going on in Vietnam to our own troops was bad, so we're not going to show it. We're not going to show coffins. We're not going to do these things. So there is like a remove.
Yeah, how do you have a low footprint war? It's like you use technology, you use a lot of drones, you try and have an occupation force with as few people as possible, and you use the fucking shock and awe attack tactics, right, of overwhelming military technological superiority to try and avoid having the war actually touch Americans' lives. That's the have your cake and eat it too. And I think they have to do that because of the false premise of the war in Iraq.
Seeing your series was great year by year because it really did reinforce how George Bush's attitude was changing as the years went on. Because in the early days, he had this moral stance that was like, this is the right thing to do. We're going to persevere and we're going to see a better world on the other side. And then by 2006, 2007, he's giving speeches where he's like, Iraqis, it's their fault. Like, they don't know how to do government. They hung Saddam Hussein in a barbaric display that was not in accordance with civilized society. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, you'll cut to the destruction that the U.S. military has done to Iraq. And it's like, oh, okay, yeah, their problem is they don't have civilized values. That's the reason that this state-making project isn't working. Not the fact that the country has been leveled. And we're trying to do this with as little involvement as possible.
You know, I was pleased with the trials they got. I was disappointed and felt like they fumbled, particularly the Saddam Hussein execution. It reinforced doubts in people's minds that the Maliki government and the unity government of Iraq is a serious government, mm-hmm. and which makes it harder for me to make the case to the American people that this is a government that does want to unify the country and move forward. But I expressed my disappointment to Prime Minister Maliki when I talked to him the other day.
Message, not a good one about the government?
Well, the message is that it's a confusing message. It basically says to people, look, you conducted a trial and gave Saddam justice that he didn't give to others, but then when it came time to execute him, it looked like it was kind of a revenge mm-hmm. killing. And it sent a mixed signal to the American people and the people around the world. And it just goes to show that this is a government that's still got some maturation to do.
Yeah. Back when 9/11 had happened and they were deciding what to do and who to go after, again, it was like this huge spectacle that it scared people, it angered people, and he would kind of reflect that. And that was when you get basically clash of civilization talk, and it's like, we're going to get them. And part of what I wanted to do with the series too was to not have these moments as like a gotcha, where he's like, yeah, these guys are brutal, they'll kill you just like that. And yeah. Then cut to a bombing where a busload of people died, just people going about their day. They died. Not supposed to be a gotcha, but again, just to highlight the kind of contradictions and how someone like him has these contradictions in his head, and it just, that's how he operates. That's how he goes about his day. It's not really supposed to be a gotcha. It's like, but you said, kind of like a West Wing moment. It's just to be like, this is what they say, and they'll say a different thing later, and it has nothing to do with them being hypocrites or whatever. It's just, it has to be this way, so it has to fit, and nothing's really going to change that. I mean, you talk about World War II, that is our sent to becoming the unipolar power. You know, I mean, back then it was just like the Cold War. There were two powers, and then all of a sudden it's us now. But part of what we did was based off of the war. We had a war economy, and we kind of just kept it going. So how much of that after the Soviet Union is gone, how do you keep that going? And, you know, part of it is this. I'm not saying these things happened so we could still like manufacture and sell arms, but that is obviously in the forefront of people in power's mind to keep things going.
Yeah, I got the sense watching your series that I was kind of reminded of us having to have some kind of ideological struggle and enemy. And so it's like, oh, we were at our best when we were fighting fascism, and then for years we like ideologically fought communism, and now we're in this end of history era, and who is the next great enemy? And it's like, oh great, we have this made up thing, Islamofascism, or like whatever you want to call it, the global war on terror, on the concept of terror, that we can now have this civilizational struggle against, or George Bush can attempt to frame it that way.
Bin Laden and his terrorist allies have made their intentions as clear as Lenin and Hitler before them. And the question is, will we listen? Some in Washington should spend more time responding to the warnings of terrorists like Osama bin Laden, and less time responding to the demands of MoveOn.org bloggers and Code Pink protesters.
Yeah, it was so fascinating seeing all of the black and white, Manichaean, there's those who love life and liberty, and there's those who hate it. Seeing Bush say they hate our freedom, because I feel like when Russia invaded Ukraine, this type of rhetoric came back of like good versus evil, dictator, plucky little Ukraine. And then the war between Israel and Hamas in Gaza happened, and all that rhetoric went away again. America has a very schizophrenic relationship with their foreign policy language, where sometimes it's like, yep, we're in this existential fight of good and evil, of freedom and liberty versus tyranny and oppression. And then other times, in moments of more honesty, you'll see them talk about the geopolitical chess set. I mean, I think fucking Trump, I mean, he's not a chess player, obviously, but he'll talk about how America likes and needs dictators and how he himself likes some of these dictators. But it's like, I don't know, in our existential fight against Islamism, Islamofascism, why is Saudi Arabia still in this camp? Like, don't worry about it. Don't think about it. It's the geopolitical chess set. You can't manage it. But yeah, I mean, I think the Israel war has showed us that there is no ideology and there is no pragmatism. It's just the hour of the wolf.
Yeah. It's so confusing, though, because you bring up Russia and Ukraine, and then Russia was always kind of like a boogeyman for a while. And then, especially with Trump, because he was like married Putin, you know?
Right, so yes.
Every time you would hear that, you'd read an article or something, sometimes there'd be a hammer and sickle. And it's just like, no, like, it's not the Soviet Union. You can't do that. That's not what they're doing. And then I remember talking to family members, and they would know Putin, but they would still refer to Russia as the Soviet Union. And it's like, it's not like, oh my God. And they must know what they're doing when they do these things. Some people are just stupid. I believe the term is useful idiot, but it ends up being this confusing thing. And then it's like, okay, now with Israel and Palestine, it's like, well, Hamas is ISIS, but then ISIS is back now and ISIS is doing this thing. And you're like, at least people being very, very misinformed. And then what do you do? What can you do with that, with the correct information?
Yeah, I mean, this is something that I'm stealing from the Chapos, my favorite podcasters, but it's something Amber said on an episode where she was like, foreign policy is not complicated. If you ask most people, the simple foreign policy is don't do any wars and try and take in the refugees. That's it. And I feel like Americans do have a non-interventionist streak, famously, but they get bamboozled by everything we're talking about. This incoherent mix of the existential struggle that you are faced with, where we're going to use the fucking orange alerts to get you keyed up. Also, we're going to encourage your fears. We're going to like throw fuel on that bonfire. Or people start to ask questions about foreign policy, but why the 800 and 900 bases? There's always it's too complicated and you just don't understand. Leave it to the experts, the technocratic answer.
It kind of reminds me of my age at this time, because I was a freshman in high school and things didn't make sense to me. Okay, so a bunch of guys hit us, the World Trade Center and all these things, and we're like the biggest army in the world. How is this not going to be easy? Well, you know, it's like, it's going to be complicated. And it was, but my mind was always just like, it seems kind of plain as day. And then I had people basically, until I realized that I was more right back then than I was, where it's just like, oh no, it's more complicated than that.
It's hard to think about without getting very discouraged thinking about empire and foreign policy. So
empire sucks.
Let's move it along to one of Bush's self-described victories. You have a clip towards the end of your doc where I think it's the 2008 episode. A reporter asks Bush about some of his dubs, pun intended.
I tell people I leave town with a great sense of accomplishment and my head held high. We reformed education and test scores for minority students are up. We lower taxes for everybody who pays taxes. We transformed our military to make it be able to deal more effectively with the threats of the 21st century and put good judges on the bench. Drug use for teenagers is down in America by about 25%. The air is cleaner. The water is pure. The armies of compassion are more invigorated than ever before. We dealt with an economic meltdown with strong action so that our successor has a better chance of dealing with the economic fallout from the credit crisis. We protected this country from harm, and we did so by providing tools and for our professionals. Concurrent with that, we've promoted the freedom agenda. 50 million people are now free in Afghanistan and Iraq.
he says that education reform is one of his big wins, which is fucking hilarious because No Child Left Behind, I mean, the bill is hundreds of pages, we can't get into the weeds right now, but was so reviled and failed so spectacularly that most of it was actually repealed in 2014-15, somewhere around there, towards the end of Obama. They repealed most of it because it was not good. The Bush administration, and this is another issue, like the empire that's sadly nonpartisan, not a friend of the public school system. And so No Child Left Behind was something of a cudgel to be used against public education. The crux of the bill was that there was going to be much more standardized testing, and schools that weren't living up to standards would get their funding cut and in some extreme cases get closed. Because what the right wing wants for education always is to kill public education and replace it with some kind of vouchers or charter schools. Vouchers to go to private or religious education, but independent school choice is their favorite thing. And I think a lot of it has to do with teachers' unions being one of the last bastions of organized labor. But there's also some weird hidden stuff that I wasn't aware of in No Child Left Behind. I was watching a video on YouTube about it before we hopped on and started recording. One of the provisions buried deep in the bill was actually that schools had to give up information about their students to the armed forces for recruiting purposes. That's the kind of shit that was buried even in the education bills, which is wild. And they did. The U.S. military did.
That's another thing, too, where it's like, oh, my God, the people voting on the bills half the time do not read, famously.
You mentioned in the doc, after Hurricane Katrina, right, they were still reforming education down there in New Orleans. And that was one of my favorite parts of the doc, was your coverage of Hurricane Katrina, because you brought in some stuff that I, who lived through it, was not aware of and had not heard of. I knew about the privatization by the New Orleans schools. Like, there are no more public schools in New Orleans anymore. It's all charter schools for the most part. But you mentioned all this stuff I hadn't heard of, like diverting electricity to pipelines to keep them running through the crisis, diverting energy from people who need it, Blackwater gangs rolling through. Yeah, just some brutal, brutal stuff. Yeah, tell us a bit more about Katrina, because I noticed in the doc, it's where you editorialize a little bit more. I say for the better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's another thing that was like, I obviously knew it was bad, but it was a lot grosser than I had realized. And the full implications of that, I don't think are widely known. And I also wanted to drive that home, because it is something that is, you know, you'd be like, well, people don't know or care about the Middle East. It's not even on the same continent. But here we are. This is a part of us, a part of our country, and this is what happened. And one of the scarier things, I mean, obviously you don't want private security walking around here, mm-hmm. like Blackwater. And essentially they did this because of the kind of shock doctrine thing, where something this insane, destructive, I don't want to say natural occurrence, it could be prevented, but you know, something happens that causes a lot of destruction, and through its wake things are kind of strip mined, so they're like privatized and there's literal murder. And this is essentially what they do in other countries. And they're straight up doing it here and taking advantage of a disaster. And one of the crazier things is that people in the actual communities would go around shooting other people and kind of made a game out of it, bragged about it. There's a documentary that talks about it.
Welcome to New Orleans.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah, where people, okay, you know, just be straight up like white people talk about shooting black people and literally like, oh, yeah, it was like pheasant season. We just did it. And they're like, yeah, well, you know, they were robbing stores, so we didn't want them to rob us next, which, to give them some benefit of the doubt, I don't want to, but it's just like, okay, like that sort of checks out. You don't want someone coming into your home, but given the context of that, you're just like, wait, so you saw people who were trying to live robbing stores that were closed or whatever, the stuff's going to go to waste, and then you just assume they're going to do something, so you shoot them, and then with their gleeful tone, it's just like, all right, you're just full of shit. You're just aren't actually like things were like, oh, they came into my house, you know, like, none of that happened. But yeah, this is another thing that we didn't really reckon with.
Yeah, and I vaguely remember the stories around it. What I remembered was not the horrifying things that you brought out in your documentary. I remember the scandal being the FEMA director was this Bush patronage appointee, like someone he played golf with or whatever the hell, right? Who was totally underqualified to do disaster management and logistics. And, you know, Bush is out there on the streets of New Orleans going, hey, he's doing a heck of a job. And the media cycle was like, a heck of have a job, sir, whatever. This was the scandal. But I think the arc of the past 20 something odd years is the like intense erosion of people's faith in the government and institutions. I hate to sound like a fucking lib here, because this is what the Trump discourse was like. But FEMA can't keep you safe. They don't want to. They ran the same playbook back during the Trump administration when a hurricane hit Puerto Rico. The same like disaster capitalists came in to try and run the same script.
Yeah. And that's important that you said that people lose faith in the system. And that is how you get someone like Trump.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it happens. But there's also, I hesitate to blame everything on the 70s neoliberal turn, but that's when a lot of shit happened, when it's like the kind of New Deal consensus started to break away and you're getting a lot more breaking of unions, privatizing public programs, doing more with less so that people expect less from them and they can do so little that people lose faith in them. And then through that, they kind of cut away. It's funny because it's another contradiction, because it's like, okay, here are very useful, great programs that could be very improved on. And instead, we're going to strip them away so that people then don't believe in the government. But you have to believe in the government because it's the best we got. So you can't have like some reality TV guy in there, because we really, it's a great thing that we have. But like, don't expect too much from these public programs. Like, there's so much bureaucratic bullshit, which is not in the privatized area. That does not happen.
Yeah, right. The contradiction of, you know, Ronald Reagan saying, I'm from the government, I'm here to help. The scariest words in the English language. Also, I, a spokesperson from the government, am telling you that we need to invade Iraq.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's brutal shit. Okay, let's move on. I think those are the main beats we want to hit on the Bush presidency. Katrina, global war on terror, 2000s election. I'm sure you can expect episodes on some or all of these topics down the line. But yeah, why don't we talk a little bit about Means TV and the doc?
So yeah, if you're a listener of this show, you may be familiar with Means TV, but it is a worker-owned digital streaming service co-op. So there's no advertisers, there's no venture capitalist money, according to their press kit. They support themselves through nearly 10,000 monthly subscribers. It was started by two Detroit area guys. Go Lions.
Oh, hell yeah. Go Lions.
Auto advertising media work and shifted over to make this platform to help the left. So one of the first things they did was make a campaign ad for AOC. And now they have a series with Brian Quimby and this excellent series, Miss Me Yet, from our guests. So a really interesting platform, because you don't usually see things that don't take advertiser or venture capitalist money.
Oh, yeah. We're going to be doing dick pill ad reads as soon as we can. Don't you worry about it.
Yeah. So, yeah, it seems perfect for your series as well, this platform.
It came at a really interesting time because I'm 10 to 15 years into being a filmmaker, which is so sad and weird, but I am. And all the avenues are kind of obvious on what to do after you make a film. And they're not really good unless you have help making a film, such as like money or like crazy big actors. But Means TV has been a really great opportunity to have a say in the distribution process and what you can do with a platform utilizing a streaming service with a certain amount of reach. And that's been a lot of fun as a co-op member. You kind of hear what's going on the platform, what are the plans, you kind of make working groups to figure out a new path to chart, that kind of thing, what you want to get into. And that's been a lot more fun than just being like, okay, what film festivals do I want to spend $50 to and hope that they even watch? It's kind of like there's like a little pool of power that was created, and how do we kind of expand that power and do good with it? And in this case, like something like Miss Me Yet, using archival footage, which is, you know, tainted, and where else was it going to go but on YouTube? And, you know, if you put something on YouTube, then you could be censored because of music choices. And how could I make a series about the Bush presidency without including like Ashley Simpson or Soulja Boy or something like that? So it was a great opportunity to put it out there with some sort of power behind it, of just being like promotion instead of just dropping it on YouTube and doing things myself. It's like people coming together for like a common cause of doing worker-focused media and being kind of broad in that sense, like whatever that means, like we do it and we're going to support it. And it's been great. It's a much more fruitful experience than just everyone being their lone kind of yeoman filmmaker doing their own thing. That has not worked out. So it's been really great.
Can I ask you, why did you name the doc Miss Me Yet?
Well, I assume you're familiar with the meme.
Yes.
But we'll explain a meme. At a certain point, very early on, to Obama's presidency, there was a billboard, so a kind of cheeky George Bush picture of him waving, and it said, "Miss me yet?" And it's funny, it happened very, 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 very immediately. Mm-hmm. And it was an actual billboard, and then the internet was like growing and growing, and then it was a billboard in, I believe, one place, but it kind of traveled far on the internet. And it sort of took on its own thing of being a joke, me yet. And it was one of the first memes that kind of still has a life. And because we're tackling George Bush in the way of being, you're seeing him rehab, you're seeing him hugging Michelle Obama, and it's like, oh, he's not so bad. Mm-hmm. It seemed too good of a title of just being like, oh, they're being like facetious and just probably racist and all of these things. When they put that billboard up, and then it became a meme where it took a life of its own. And because my series is about this, how could I not then just take this title?
Yeah, I think it's a great title because it calls back to how short people's memories are, right? That someone could unironically say, "Miss me yet," like 2 months into Obama's presidency.
Yeah.
And then actually, people did start missing him. Like, libs were like, "Oh, I miss when Republicans were good and normal, like W."
Yeah, it was too good. The only thing I didn't, there's like a song that came out like exactly when the series came out called "Miss Me Yet." So it makes it a little hard to Google sometimes. But look, everything's hard to Google now, so not a big deal.
Another thing I really like about your doc is that there's no voiceover. You let the archival footage speak for itself, especially when you put things back to back or juxtapose. And your voiceover is very minimal, except for the title cards at the end, which I think are almost always incredibly powerful. What made you choose this approach for your documentary?
Voiceover has always bothered me as a tool in film, and I like movies with voiceover, but it does tend to feel a little crowded to me, and it's not really an approach that I ever saw myself doing. And part of the fire I had to do the series was kind of appreciating and sitting with the old footage and just being like, oh, what would it be like if you just get, you're in a room, in a dark room, and just like you have to watch Bush speaking, and what would that do to you? And then having title cards, like after you've seen everything, kind of like try to sum up or add new information, and how would this information feel to you after seeing all of these things? That very simple technique and storytelling, I felt like there was a lot of potential there. So not that there was ever a yearn to do voiceover, but I felt like that was strong enough, and I felt like it was kind of unexplored. Again, I don't want to knock voiceover, but it does feel like sometimes it's used as a crutch. It's used in a way that to me could be a little condescending, or like, oh, you're not going to get it. So I wanted to see what I could mine out of what little I had. And then the title cards, I didn't want to do too many, but I also wanted to do something that they do in Metal Gear Solid, to bring it up again. But that series is crazy because every game ending is like 2 hours, and there's tons of cutscenes, and then there's like a very serious scroll of text that places the game's events within events that actually happened in our real world. And it's very stark. It's very serious. And then you see more I just thought it was so badass. And I was like, how do I replicate that feeling in this? And I did it, I guess. or like that was like part of the reason why I did that as well.
Yeah, actually, that brings up the character of Bush, I think, is extremely interesting and something that we've talked about a lot on our pod, because we were watching this with our German friend who's fairly apolitical and so had never really thought about George Bush before. And his reaction to seeing a lot of the clips in this doc was like, he seems like a cool guy to have a beer with. Which, because so much of this doc is Bush showing up to every cultural event and dancing. He was our resident goo.
Motherfucker loved to dance. Oh my God. When I watched this doc, I was like, this was the last president who had a good time while being president, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that was part of his value pitch was, hey, I'm a cool guy to have a beer with. You would want to hang out with me, and I seem down to earth, right? And we told our German friend, like, yeah, that's what he was going for. That was kind of his whole thing. And I thought that the doc did a good job of sort of reinforcing how he was willing to play the Michael Scott figure when he wasn't talking about war in the Middle East. And sometimes even when he was talking about war in the Middle East, right? We actually start every episode with that amazing clip of George Bush saying, we won't stop until we kill all of these terrorist killers. Now watch this drive, you know, blending the goof and the war leader personas together. I guess, I don't know if it's so much of a question, but I really just did enjoy you reinforcing this part of Bush's persona that was what he was offering people, which was, hey, I'm Michael Scott. I'm this president goofball, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that was part of the image image, the spectacle, and I try to do that where it's like they're literally selling dolls of him. Mm-hmm. It's a performance. And to some degree, every president has to do it. The ones that win, obviously they're set in stone, so it's like a little bit hard to say, but they all have this kind of affable presence, this charisma to one degree or another. It's interesting because I was watching the Alexandra Pelosi documentary, Journeys with George, where she did a documentary just following him around his presidential run, which is funny now that I think about it, because she doesn't get into the recount, really. I don't think. Interesting. But it's her hanging out with the rest of the press, and then she's with George sometimes alone, and he's very quick. He's very just like, Ms. Pelosi, like, I like what you did with your hair. He's always quick to say something that's kind of funny. There's a clip from it that went around a little bit where she's like playfully asking him questions. She's like, what's your favorite tree? And he's like, I'm not a tree, I'm a bush. Very quick, and it's very like so stupid it's funny. But
yeah, you got a few good clips of him crushing at humor.
He's funny. Look, Trump is funny too.
Mm-hmm.
It just is. But it's one of those things where it's just because Trump was so much crasser, it was easier for people to see through it and be very upset. Someone like Bush, he was more personable, more of like, look, we just disagree, but we can hang out.
Mm-hmm.
Which disregards the power he comes from, the wealth, yes, and all of that, and then the power he then wields.
Mm-hmm.
You had a beer with him, he would make you forget that. And mm-hmm. That's something to think about as well.
Actually, great segue. Speaking of performances by powerful people, could you explain the fucking dog videos? So for those of you who haven't seen Mispy yet, they filmed what appears to have been a yearly video in which the most evil people in America talk to Barney the Scottish Terrier as if he's a human and tell him that he's responsible for decorating the White House for Christmas or some shit. But I'm just imagining a world where centuries go by and historians are looking at the Barney the Dog tapes, be like, ah, there's Karl Rove, the man who sewered John McCain's presidential campaign by implying he had a bastard illegitimate black daughter in South Carolina to race bait a little bit. And also, you know, one of the hatchet men who helped launch an illegal war in Iraq. Here he is talking to a dog. Giving the dog directions on how to decorate the White House. Yeah, it gave me brain damage watching all of these dog clips. It made me into even more of a self-hating white than I usually am. Like, these fucking crackers and their dogs, man. They're heckin' doggos. So, sorry, very long preamble for my question. What's with the dog videos?
Yeah, I don't know if it was the same team, because there was kind of a jokey video about Bill Clinton's last year of the presidency where it's like Al Gore's running, so Al Gore's not around, and then Hillary is running for, I believe she was senator.
Senate, yeah.
And he's just like alone, so it's like a lot of him walking around alone, and it's like, I want to say it was like an internal video to the White House, so I think it was the same people, and like I want to say that was their first project, was the Bill Clinton thing. So then I guess they were just like, yo, we got some good. So they just kept doing stuff, and they ended up doing, maybe it was because of the whole like passionate conservatism thing of just like family, we're gonna do that, we're gonna include the dog part of the family. But it's really surreal, and it's weird to look back on, because you would think that we all would know about them because they're so fucking weird, but they never really caught on. And if you're thinking about the internet at this point, these videos were on the White House website for everyone to see, and maybe the news covered them a little bit, but nobody remembers that. It was very, very weird. It was a yearly tradition starting in maybe 2003 or something. I don't think they did it for the full presidency, but I want to say maybe it was because the internet was still very young. So they're like, we got to have this, you know, they didn't put it in these words, but some sort of propaganda effort on like this front, right? But like, what do we do? And it's like, just have fun with it, you know?
Yeah, they needed content, right? They were looking for content to post.
Yeah, but yeah, Barney passed away, and reportedly George Bush cried.
I don't blame him.
It was his son, his only son, Barney.
Yeah, I mean, I want them to bring this back. I want a video about Biden's German shepherds that are constantly biting Secret Service agents. I want a little doc about Commander and Duke and Coast Guard, or whatever the third one's name is.
One thing that I do want to say about the doc that I really loved, and I know that, yeah, you are against the gotcha moments in spirit, but some of them were so satisfying, just because there's this moment in the debate with Al Gore where he's talking about Al Gore's faults and what he perceives to be his biggest flaws, which are that Al Gore's for nation building, and that he would would enter foreign entanglements without having a clear exit strategy, and people are responsible for the actions in their life. And I just found them to be, it's just so well, I mean, this, he's saying this like in 2000. You could not have more succinctly put what his problems were going to be than the things that he was putting on Gore in those debates to say. Mm-hmm. He would go into a mission without an exit strategy. And he's like, dude, like, yeah, you're going to start like two 20-year occupations.
Yeah, it's really weird. And then there was another one where he's like, oh, we should take care of this now and not put it on future generations. Yeah, again, there's a way that I wanted to use them and not have them as gotchas. And I think maybe the counter would be like, well, don't use them. My counter would be like, how could I not use that?
Mm-hmm.
How could you not put that in there? But I think the takeaway has to be important, where it's just, what does that lead you to think? What does that lead you to believe about who's running for office, what they say?
I took it in as projection, as just his own fears about himself are coming out as he's attacking Gore.
Yeah, I mean, like, what else was he going to do?
Speaking of, you, when you said, how could I not use this? Is there anything you wish you could have included in the doc but didn't have time for that just ended up on the cutting room floor?
Not really. There's so much stuff in there. Like, sometimes I'll think of, like, a commercial or something that I remember, like, ah, I've been funny in there. I put in a Dragon Ball Z commercial because that's stupid for me to not have in there. So that one in, like, I want to say August, and the series came out in September. I put that in late, and then I found that VR footage from the last episode of the PTSD VR Iraqi soldier, and that was too good, and I was just like, oh my god, this was not going to be in there. So I like put that in there.
Say what you will about America, it is the greatest country on earth to be a quack in. If you are a quack, this is your mecca. This guy, yeah. For those who haven't seen it, there's this psychiatrist who treats PTSD by putting soldiers in a VR, in like a late 2000s VR, and just having them relive exactly their trauma over and over again. Listen, I'm not an expert, but this can't be real. This can't possibly work.
Yeah, that's really strange. And you can see all of the like missions and stuff. I believe it's all on YouTube. So if you want, you can literally watch every, like, the video game, like, from start to finish. And you can experience what it's like to be going through these therapy sessions.
How many hours of ads did you have to watch to make this series? Is this stuff you mostly remembered, or were you just binging 2000s era advertisements? Because I did think that what is being sold to us always does represent a certain level of insecurity that we had at the time. You know, like, advertising is like creating a need and then filling it. And so just, yeah, having the reminder of how these loans were being offered, like, oh, it's easy money, you no qualifications needed.
Something missing from your wallet? If it's a Visa credit card, call the toll-free number and meet these simple requirements. We guarantee to issue you a credit card with no upfront cash security deposit, regardless of your past credit history.
Or the Botox, that was always a great reminder of what was on our minds at the time, to see, hey, what was being sold to you was probably a certain part of what was occupying your brain at the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not many compared to all the amount of Bush I had to watch, but it's generally just like, okay, like, I obviously want banking commercials because I want to lead up to that. And then, you know, like, what about a food commercial? What about promos for what's on TV? But yeah, the vaguer things, just like, well, what bank commercial? And then what food promos? But yeah, not that many, because they're commercials. So there's very upfront about what they're doing in many ways. So like, it's basically like what works in the cut and what doesn't. But didn't have to watch much to be like, wow, there's 70 perfect things, and now I need 5. So then you just go from there. So it was like very, very easy, thankfully, to go through that. And that was, you know, nostalgia can be very bad and evil, but you do have to indulge sometimes. So it was like, kind of, it wasn't the worst thing to just be like, oh yeah, watching this Sears commercial about air conditioning.
Hell yeah. I think that's all we got. I think we're just about ready to wrap up. That's been our little foray into the Bush administration. Huge thank you to our guests for coming on. And yeah, go watch this doc. Get a Means TV subscription. They do have a 7-day free trial. And watch Miss Me Yet.
I should say, by the way, Ben, you do not need a Means TV subscription to watch the Miss Me Yet series. You can watch it without it.
If you live through it, it'll give you psychic damage.
Yeah, and are there any other works of yours that you'd like to plug, Chris?
I have a feature, Failed State, but that's currently playing at a festival near you, hopefully. You could check out the trailer. It's on the film stage. I'm not going to say the URL, so just Failed State, the film stage.
Mm-hmm. We'll put it in the description.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's on your Twitter bio as well, I believe, right?
Check me out on Twitter. Check out the info wherever you're listening to this. It'll be in there. And then, yeah, Miss Me Yet. So Miss Me Yet is free. You don't need to be a Means TV subscriber. Filmmaker. You can just watch it. But my first feature, The Winds That Scatter, is on Means TV, as long as a lot of other amazing things, such as Preserving Worlds and Seize the Memes and Means Morning News, blah, blah, blah. And whatever you give us, we could put into the project that is Means TV. So subscribers really help. There is a 7-day free trial. That was good. Thank you for that. And I believe it's $10 a month after that. But there is also a sliding scale where you kind of pay what you can. So we're very open to you being with us. So please join.
Chris Bell's Twitter, by the way, is Update the Grid, right? At Update the Grids.
Yeah, I don't know why, but that's what it is.
Yeah, and we can't recommend the series highly enough. As we've said over the course of the episode, just a panoply of memories that you had forgotten, that you didn't know you have.
Mm-hmm.
Core memories unlocked, as they say. Watching the elephants humping. You know, So check it out, and more George Bush to come, hopefully in depth as we go along. So thank you for joining us, as always.
Please like, subscribe. We repost Instagram stories at Shout Out Remember Shuffle. We respond to every YouTube comment. Yeah, give us some love. Please, all hail the algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you want us to get more subscribers so you can start hearing us do dick pill ad reads? Don't you want us to tell you about a mattress that you can order in the mail or whatever?
Don't you want to hear us tell you about Kratom and how great it is?
All right, thanks as always for listening. Ciao ciao.
Bye. See ya. Miss me in.
Thank you. Love the show. Thanks for having me on.
I've paid a price, and I